So I want to thank the organizer of this meeting, and particularly Nasser for this nice conference and this kind invitation to be here. So I will speak of a common work with Gianni Landi, who is the last speaker of yesterday, on the generalization of the approach by Henri Cartan of the vague homomorphism. And this is a very elegant approach, and our aim is to give a non-commutative generalization of the small setting. So our first task was to construct the universal object in the non-commutative setting, which correspond to the Weil algebra. Weil is André Weil, and Cartan is not Élie Cartan, but his son, Henri Cartan. Okay, so this appeared some months ago in Communication in Mathematical Physics. It's the first part of this work. It remains some difficult part again, but you will see that we have nevertheless overcome to a lot of non-obvious things. So the time is short, so I will be relatively quick for the result that I will use on the cohomology of Lie algebra, the definition of the enveloping differential calculus of an associative algebra, and the classical theory of Cartan-Weil, say. So the classical theory which I want to generalize, because otherwise nothing is intelligible. Okay. So let me start with the cohomology of the Lie algebra. So assume that you start from a finite dimensional vector space, G, Gothic G, with an antisymmetric product. So you have a linear map from the second exterior power of G into G. And by transposition, you obtain a linear map from the dual of G in the second exterior power of the dual of G. I put a minus to be in accordance with the usual convention, but it's absolutely, it makes nothing. So it's clear that since the exterior algebra is the free algebra generated by G star, this transpose of the product extend as an antiderivation of degree one of the exterior algebra over G star. Now you have a first lemma, which says that the Jacobi identity for this antisymmetric product is equivalent to the fact that D is a differential. Okay? So you have an anti-equivalent between the category of Lie algebra and the category of free differential algebra generated in degree one. Okay, the proof is straightforward, but I will need another. So the cohomology of this is what I call the cohomology of the Lie algebra. It's a cohomology of the Lie algebra in the trivial module. And there is another representation of the same object, which we will use, more precisely the generalization of which we will use in our generalization later, which is that can be computed as the Hochschild cohomology of the universal enveloping algebra of the Lie algebra. Namely, the ground field is a trivial module there, because the universal enveloping algebra of a Lie algebra is a Hopf algebra. In particular, it has a co-unit. And with the co-unit, you can define a structure of B-module on the ground field. And therefore, you can look at the Hochschild cohomology of U of G with value in this trivial bimodule. And the result, which is classical, is that this is, again, the cohomology of the Lie algebra. Okay. So somehow, one can use a substitute of the exterior algebra over the dual of the Lie algebra, the cochain, which is a multilinear form, say, on the enveloping algebra with the Hochschild differential, which is defined above. Okay. So now let me remind you something on the universal differential calculus over an associative algebra, which I call differential, not only me, the differential of envelope of the associative algebra. So assume that I is an algebra and M is an A bimodule. Then there is a notion of derivation of A in M, which is just a linear mapping satisfying the Leibniz rule. And there is a particular, we shall introduce a particular such derivation. So particular bimodule will be the kernel of the product of my associative algebra. So it's a sub-bimodule of A tensor A, okay? For multiplication, so like that. Then I define an antiderivation by setting, naturellement, c'est pas bon. Il est où le truc? Ah voilà. By setting dx equal 1 tensor x minus x tensor 1. Okay. You verify easily that, of course, it's valued in omega 1 of A. If you take the product, it's 0. And it satisfies the Leibniz rule, so it's easy to verify. And now you have the following theorem, which characterizes this particular derivation of the universal initial object, the universal object, namely, for any derivation of A in a bimodule M, then there is a unique homomorphism of bimodule from omega 1 of A into M, such that the derivation factorized like with this homomorphism and the D, which I call the universal derivation for obvious reasons. Okay? Now, with this omega 1, this bimodule, we can consider the tensor algebra over A of this bimodule. Okay? This is the graded algebra, which in degree zero is the original algebra. And I claim that there is a unique differential of this graded algebra, which extends d from a to into omega 1 of a. That is d from omega 0 of a into omega 1 of a. Okay, this is more or less classical. And this gives the universal envelope, the differential envelope of the associative algebra A, namely, it satisfies the following property. For any homomorphism alpha of algebra from A into the element of degree zero of a graded differential algebra, then such an homomorphism has a unique extension as a homomorphism of differential graded algebra from omega of A into omega. So this is a universal object above all the differential calculus. Okay. So now I enter in the classical theory of Henri Cartan. Such it is the exposition of Henri Cartan in 1950 in Brussels. So start with a Lie algebra. It will always mean finite dimensional Lie algebra, and what I say, and omega is a differential graded algebra. So I open a slight parenthesis here. In the Cartan framework, this is defined only for graded commutative algebra. But as far as Cartan operations are concerned, this can be defined for an arbitrary graded differential algebra. It will be only when I will define connection that we shall need to come back to the class, to the commutative setting. So an operation of J in or a J operation in omega is a linear mapping X give I of X of J into the antiderivation of degree minus one of the graded differential algebra, the graded algebra here, which is such that if I define L of X as the anticommutator with the differential, so this is the derivation of degree zero, okay, then it satisfies the following, it satisfies this equation, which I call the Cartan equation. This I will refer to this as the Lie derivative because it's convenient and it's an obvious algebraic generalization of the usual Lie derivative. So it follows from this that I have this identity and that L defines an homomorphism of Lie algebra from G into the derivation of degree zero of the differential algebra omega. Okay? So I will say that an element of omega is invariant if it is killed by all the Lx. Okay? It's horizontal if it is killed by all the Ix, and it is basic if it is horizontal and invariant. So this terminology comes from the classical, the following classical example of what that Cartan had behind the head, of course. You look at the different, for omega, you take the differential form on a principal bundle whose structure group has G as Lie algebra. Okay? Then X is R, the vertical vector field which corresponds to the right action of the structure group. And so invariant horizontal is clear, and basic means simply that these are the form on the basis pulled back by the inverse image of the projection, which is injective, so it's really corresponds to the basic thing. So you have a category of G operation, which is obvious. If you have two G operations, so two differential algebra with with operation like that, so homomorphism of differential algebra, which intertwine between the two operations such they are defined here. Okay, so the first thing on which I jump, which cannot be think in the framework, in the commutative framework, where the differential algebra are graded commutative, is I look at G operation in the differential envelope. So you are, R is an associative algebra, unital, it's always understood like that, and omega is the differential envelope of R. Okay? Then the lemma is the first lemma is the following. You give you a mapping from your Lie algebra, okay, into the derivation of your algebra. So the derivation of your algebra in itself. Okay? Then there is a unique G operation in the differential algebra omega of A, such that the Lx, as defined before in term in function of the operation, is an extension of my original homomorphism L0. Okay? So for the proof, I will not give any proof, but everything is very easy. The proof, you use the universal property of the derivation from A in omega 1 of R and the universal property of the differential envelope. Okay. So then you have the following theorem. If omega is a differential algebra, which is generated as differential algebra in degree zero, which means it's generated by A and the differential of R, okay, then any G operation in omega is the quotient of a unique G operation in the differential envelope of in omega of R. Okay, and in fact, of course, this uniqueness comes from the universal property of omega of R, and the fact then. It's a fact that there is a unique operation above, which is go down by this way onto omega. So this means that the operation in a differential algebra, which is generated in degree zero as differential algebra, can be identified with an operation in the enveloping the differential envelope of the subalgebra of element of degree zero. And this is something which will be useful, as you will see. So this is already something typically non-commutative. Now, okay. So these are technical lemma to prove this thing, but okay, you can. So now I want to start to shake a little the Cartan theory to have something which I will be able to generalize. That was the way we took with Jenny. So you see, since X give L of X is a Lie algebra homomorphism, in view of the universal property of the universal enveloping algebra, it extends as an algebra homomorphism from the enveloping algebra into the endomorphism of degree zero of omega, since it was in the derivation of degree zero. Okay. And the theorem is the following. You have it you have to verify it directly. This canonical extension, I call this a canonical extension, satisfies the following. Of course, they commute with the differential. L of one is the co-unit time the unit of the enveloping algebra. If I take LH of a product, okay, it is given by LH1 of alpha, LH2 of beta, where the coproduct of the enveloping algebra, of the element H in the enveloping algebra, is defined by this. Okay? So, this is very easy to prove, because, of course, this is true if H is in the Lie algebra, and then you use the fact that the coproduct is multiplicative. Okay? And then you find this easily. Less obvious is this partial generalization of the Cartan relation that you can verify directly. But you see, what I call add of H is one of this adjoint action. I think it is called the right adjoint action. It's defined by this way. Okay. So you have all this property. Okay. Fine. So now, concerning the extension of I, of my operation to U of G, then there is no canonical extension. By this I mean that there is no extension which can be expressed uniquely in terms of Hopf algebra property of the universal enveloping algebra, which is what I want, of course, for the generalization later. Nevertheless, there is an extension which is given by setting I bar of xn plus 1 equal L of xn, I of x, for n an integer. And of course, this defines, in view of Poincaré-Pirkovic theorem, this defines completely I bar of h, for h arbitrary in the enveloping algebra. Then this satisfies the following property. From first, I of 1 is 0. Second, the L of H, which is canonically defined, satisfies this property. And third, the Cartan relation generalizes in this way. Okay? So the only merit of this extension is that this shows that this relation of this are compatible, that they are good relations. So it's a relation that I will try to cut to get later. Okay. So now, an algebraic connection. So to define the algebraic connection in the framework of Cartan, I come back to the case where omega is graded commutative. Otherwise, this has not much meaning. So an algebraic connection is a linear mapping from the dual of the Lie algebra into the element of degree one of my differential algebra, such that for any x in the Lie algebra and theta linear form on the Lie algebra, I had the following identity. So this says that this is the horizontality, the verticality of the connection, and this is the invariance. So alpha extend since any in view of the universal property of the exterior algebra, alpha extend as a nomomorphism of graded algebra from the exterior algebra in the dual of the Lie algebra into my graded differential algebra. Okay. So the curvature, in fact, is defined to be the obstruction of this to be an homomorphism of graded differential algebra. So essentially, you see the curvature, you will define it as a mapping of G star in omega 2, which is defined by phi of theta is d alpha of theta minus alpha of d of theta. So you see, this is exactly the obstruction to for this mapping to be an homomorphism of differential algebra. Okay, with this definition, you have that the curvature is horizontal, is invariant. Okay, so you can write everything, of course, in terms of this this homomorphism, and I will write it like that later. Okay. So this is there is another formulation which is probably better for the more usual for the physicist, which is to say that it is an element of G tensor omega 1 and the correspondence is here, and then the relation are here, and the curvature is defined by this. Okay. But this. So now I come to the Weyl algebra. So what is the Weyl algebra? I could define it like that. It's the universal initial object in the category of operation with connection. Okay? This is a good way to define it. We have to show that it exists, of course, then it is unique up to an isomorphism, of course. So to define it, first I define it as an algebra, just the tensor product of the exterior algebra over J star with the symmetric algebra over J star. J star is the dual of my G algebra. But I equip this with a following graduation. Lambda, the M exterior power of J star, tensor, the N exterior power, the symmetric power of J star, is of degree M to plus 2M. That is, I give the degree 2 to the generator of the symmetric algebra here. Okay? Then I define alpha of theta to be theta tensor 1 and phi of theta to be 1 tensor theta, okay, which is of degree 2, of course. And I claim, which is almost obvious, that there is a unique differential such that d of alpha theta is alpha of d theta plus phi of theta. Okay? So setting Ix of alpha equal theta equal to theta of x, and Ix of phi theta equal to zero, you define an operation of G in this algebra with connection alpha and curvature phi. So equipped with all this structure, I'll call W of G the Weyl algebra of the Lie algebra G. Okay? Not Cartan, call it like that. Okay. So there is another presentation by changing of generator. You can say that a differential algebra is generated in degree 1 by alpha of j and in degree 2 by the differential of alpha of j. Okay. So from this, it's obvious that you have no cohomology in this. And you can say that the Weyl algebra is the free graded commutative differential envelope of the exterior algebra. Okay, I will define later free differential envelope of graded algebra in general, but here it's for the graded commutative case. Okay, so the cohomology of this Weyl algebra, the first is trivial, of course, it's defined as a contractible algebra, and the second is trivial, it's not difficult, you use the most obvious contracting homotopy for the Weyl algebra, and you verify that it is invariant. And so the invariant cohomology is also trivial. Now, for the basic cohomology, so the basic cohomology exists only in the in even degree, and is given by the the invariant polynomial of degree n of the Lie algebra for the basic cohomology in degree 2n. This comes from the fact that the horizontal element of this algebra are exactly the elements which are of the form, which are in one tensor, the symmetric algebra. And the symmetric algebra, by definition, contain only even elements. Okay? Invariants mean that they will be invariant polynomial, and since you have only even elements, the differential is zero, and so, okay. So this is completely trivial. And this is in contrast with what will occur with or the algebra later, whose basis is very hard to compute. So now, the universal property is obvious. If you have a G-operation with connection in omega, then you map the mapping the connection to the connection, okay? You have a canonical mapping of the Weyl algebra into your differential algebra, which is a morphism, a unique morphism of G-operation with connection, which shows that you have really the universal object there. Okay. So now the theorem, which is the abstract, in this frame, the Weyl homomorphism, which implies, of course, the usual Weyl homomorphism theorem, is the following. If you look at the canonical, the morphism in basic cohomology induced by the canonical homomorphism from the Weyl algebra into an operation with connection, okay, then this homomorphism does not depend on the connection of omega. So it only depends on the G operation, okay? Of course, if you apply this to the differential form of a principal bundle, this with connection, this gives you the standard formulation of the Weyl homomorphism. There is something else which can be extracted from this, is the Cartan map, which maps the invariant polynomial of degree n on the Lie algebra into the invariant form of degree 2n minus 1 of the Lie algebra. You obtain it in the following. We take an invariant polynomial of degree 2n, 1 minus p, since it is in the basic cohomology, it's a Cossacle, it's an invariant Cossacle. So, in view of the triviality of the invariant cohomology, there is an element q of degree 2n minus 1, okay, which is such that this is the differential of this element, and q can be chosen, of course, in the invariant element of the Weyl algebra. Then you use the canonical projection of the Weyl algebra onto the exterior algebra over the dual of the Lie algebra, which is also an operation, and you show relatively easily that this projection does not depend on the choice of the Q here. Okay? It only depends on the polynomial which is here. And this gives you this mapping from the invariant polynomial of degree n into the invariant form of degree 2n minus 1. Now, if you have a reductive Lie algebra, then you can show that the kernel of this Cartan map are the polynomials which are decomposable, and its image are the primitive invariant form. Okay? So this Cartan map, in this case, gives you a mapping from the free generator of the invariant polynomial algebra onto the free generator of the invariant form. Okay. So now I pass to the hard part. This part, of course, so I start, you see, I will start from a Hopf algebra, and you have to think of this as a generalization of the enveloping algebra of a Lie algebra. But you see, when you quantize thing, you are quantized enveloping algebra and no Lie algebra also. So in any case, I start from a Hopf algebra, and omega is a graduate differential algebra. And then I define an operation of, we define, in fact, it's an operation of H in omega, the linear mapping from H and into the endomorphism of degree minus one of this differential algebra, so that first I of one is zero, okay? And so that by setting LH equal the anticommutator of D with IH plus the co-unit tensor, the identity mapping, this is the co-unit applied to H tensor multiplied by the identity mapping of my differential algebra into itself, okay? One has the following identity. So you see, we generalize the antiderivation property of the IX in the case of a Lie algebra by this thing. There are very few choices to generalize that thing in a way which depends only on the structure of Hopf algebra in the case of the enveloping algebra. So this one is good, and such that then you have this relation, of course, we have already met this relation in the case of enveloping algebra, and of course this relation, okay? So this implies that I have this relation, which was expected, of course, and of course that this commute with the differential, and also that I have these two things, okay? So you have a category of H operation, okay? So this is the extension of, you see, this is the extension of Cartan relation, this is the extension of the antiderivation property. So you can say, well, classically, the Lie derivative property of the Lie derivative, the Lie algebra homomorphism of the Lie derivative, follow from the Cartan relation and the antiderivation property. Here, it's not exactly that, but nevertheless, they are strongly related. Namely, you see, this relation is equivalent to say that if I take, so the adjoint action in the sense I wrote it before on I, it is equivariant with respect to this adjoint action. But of course, when you will take this definition, it will give you also that the L of G are equivariant by this adjoint action through the L itself. And this, of course, would follow from this. But not completely in the opposite sense if you have no primitive element or thing like that, okay? So we have to put it by hand somehow, but it's not independent. Then you have all this follow, of course. Okay. So, again, you can define invariant element, basic element, by the same thing. So, an invariant alpha is invariant if LH of alpha is epsilon H times alpha. So, from this, you have that the set, it's easy to prove that the set of invariant element is a differential subalgebra of omega. And you say that an element is horizontal if it is killed by all the IH. And then you show easily that this defines a subalgebra, a graded subalgebra of the form, which is stable by the LH. And third, you say that it is basic, it is both, and this is again a differential graded algebra of this thing. So you have the notion of invariant cohomology and of basic cohomology, which is of such an operation. Okay. So now it's time to see what is the connection between an operation of J and an operation of U of J in this sense. So it's clear that if I have an operation of U of J, I can restrict it to the Lie algebra and I get an operation of my Lie algebra. But in the other direction, it's not so obvious, but what is almost obvious, very easy to prove, is that if you look at a differential envelope of an associative algebra, any operation of J in a differential envelope has a unique extension as an operation of U de J of U of J in omega of A. Okay, this is why I take the precaution to show you before that if my basic algebra, differential algebra is generated in degree zero. To give an G operation there is the same thing as to give, in some sense, as to give a G operation in the universal envelope of the subalgebra of element of degree zero of my differential algebra. Okay, so the reason of this warning is that look, you take my definition and of operation of G, an arbitrary differential graded algebra, then you have the following. It implies the following identity. So you see, I cannot have such an operation in a graded commutative algebra if this is different of zero, because this would vanish and this would vanish. So you have to take care on what, where you define an operation of Hopf algebra. So the connection is with that, through the lift to, okay. So there is a Hopf algebra, superalgebra formulation which copy the least superalgebra formulation of operation that people use in equivariant cohomology and so on. But this is, so I don't want to. So now I introduce the differential algebra C of H. That is, this will be of course the Hochschild Cochen with value in the trivial representation, that is in the ground field, equipped with a structure of B-module given by the antipode. Okay, because this, in the case of the enveloping algebra, this gives the cohomology of the Lie algebra. Okay. So this will play the same role to define the connection as the exterior algebra onto the dual of the Lie algebra. Okay, later. So, okay, we can... Well, I don't know if... So you can translate the product by transposition, and it extends as an antiderivation, okay, which is... and the associativity of mu does correspond to this. This is square equal to zero. But of course, the cohomology of this is trivial, essentially because this is something like the dual of the bar complex. So this is not interesting. But what is interesting, of course, is the Hochschild Cochen with value, so the Hochschild differential with the ground field considered as the B module, so which is given by this. Okay? So it is this that I call the differential graded algebra C of H. Okay. So now I want to define an operation into this graded differential algebra, okay, H operation. So I am a little forced because of the definition, the generalization of the antiderivation property, to define it by this, sorry, by this complicated, seemingly complicated formula. There is no, but of course, it's this complicated formula imply for the L of H, the expected formula, which is perfect, okay? And you observe that one has that the anticommutator of the IH with the Hochschild differential is the same as the anticommutator of the IH with the D0, which means that my operation IH in C of H initially define also an operation in this other differential algebra which has a trivial cohomology. So of course you have this, but I will not use that at all. So now it's a time to define connection. So I follow the same philosophy. I replace in the definition the exterior algebra over the dual of the Lie algebra by this graded algebra, and I define a connection as a homomorphism of graded algebra from C of H in omega, such that it satisfies this condition. Okay, this condition, which are directly the generalization of the verticality and equivariance condition. Okay, which in degree zero implies this condition, means this condition. Okay. So, as an example, but you take the Hochschild Cochen as before, and with as connection the identity mapping of the Hochschild Cochen over itself. as mapping of morphism of graded differential of graded algebra. Okay. So now I define the curvature exactly by the same thing. It's the obstruction of this homomorphism of graded algebra to be an homomorphism of graded differential algebra. So we define the curvature by this. This implies this. Okay. In degree, if I take an element of degree one, okay, which means this horizontality and this invariance. Okay, so in particular, of course, the canonical connection over the C of H is flat. Okay, it's the identity mapping, so it's of course an homomorphism differential algebra. Okay. So the property you can of the curvature as the following, okay, for an arbitrary psi, together with this, and now you have this property. So you see, your connection, which is an homomorphism of C of H in your differential algebra, give a structure of C of H bimodule on this differential algebra. And what means this? It means that the curvature is an antiderivation of degree one for the structure of bimodule with value in this bimodule. Okay. So you have this, and you can summarize all this relation in the very symmetrical thing with the Kossuth thing. Okay. So connection in dimension, in low dimension, is given by this. So this, of course, it has some. But I will not. Explain the construction of the universal differential envelope of a graded algebra. But the important thing is that it exists. That is, for any graded algebra A, okay, and any homomorphism you have first, graded differential algebra, which I call omega grad of A, so that for any homomorphism of graded algebra of A in a graded differential algebra, it lifts as a homomorphism of graded differential algebra omega grad in omega. So, well, this construction is explained in our paper, and it's based, in fact, on some construction introduced by Robert Cockereau and Daniel Kassler, but a little push. And then, of course, I will define the Weil algebra of a Hopf algebra exactly as the Weil algebra in the classical one. That is, it will be the universal initial object in the category of H operation with connection. Okay, and exactly for the same reason, in the graded commutative case, it was the universal graded commutative envelope of the exterior algebra over the dual of the Lie algebra. Here, it is the graded commutative differential envelope of C of H. Okay? So, now, if you take, no, if you, sorry, if you have a H operation with connection, then the connection extends uniquely by this universal property, as an homomorphism of different graded differential algebra from this algebra, differential algebra into omega. Now I define alpha w to be the canonical injection of C of H in W of H, which is the envelope, and phi w is just this. And I say that there is a unique operation in the graded algebra W of H for which alpha W is a connection with curvature omega. Okay, so this is so with you combine all these properties, you obtain immediately the theorem that I want. That we want that this is the universal object, the initial universal object in the category of algebra with connection. Okay, boom, boom. So you have this, and well, let me finish with just this concerning the cohomology. So by construction, of course, the cohomology of the this Weyl algebra is also trivial, and again, you can show that the invariant cohomology is trivial. So you have already all the weapon to do the Cartan map and things like that. And okay, and I will stop here, because now what we have to do, but we did not did up to now, is to compute the basic cohomology, which is absolutely non-trivial. But you see, it is somehow moral that this is non-trivial, because there is no good cohomological theory of Hopf algebra for the generalizing the Weyl homomorphism. And the one I know are the cohomology of the work, for instance, of Alain Cohn and Henri Moscovici, but they work with very particular Hopf algebra, which have not the square of the antipode equal to the identity, but almost. That is, it's either the identity conjugate with a group-like element, or with dually with convolution with a character. So, and we know that that there are Hopf algebra with antipodes which are not invertible. Here, in principle, we have a general thing, so it's important that we compute at some moment this this basic cohomology, which is probably a good one. So, sorry, I stop. Sorry for this little.
So, if I understood correctly, the Weyl algebra is a substitute for a principal bundle with connection. Mm-hmm. Can you build associated vector bundles with connections? Are there examples, natural examples?
Well, sure. Yes. Yes, what? There are people looking at connection on the Hopf-Galois extension and or different. And what is characteristic that all the work I have seen on this generalization of connection are connection in the sense of the universal differential calculus.
Okay.
So probably this is not an accident, because as we have seen, you cannot define on any differential algebra an operation of Hopf algebra. For instance, if it is graded commutative, you have to pass by this indirect way through the universal calculus.
Okay. And another question.
But there are in the literature there are several examples. Papers, such things.
Another question. You strongly use the finite dimensionality of your Lie algebra.
For the Lie algebra?
Yes, for the Lie algebra.
But I cannot use it for Hopf algebra, because already. An enveloping algebra is infinite dimensional.
Yes.
It's a pity, because the formula are very much more transparent in the finite dimensional case. I have seen on one of this transparency.
Okay, so this could be used for gauge type Lie algebras.
Yes.
Yes.
Sure,
okay.
Sure.
That was my question. Yes. For physics applications.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Another short question.
What could we say about this particular example of a group algebra, for example?
We did not compute. You see, we are trying hard to compute this basic cohomology, and but we. No, we did not compute really a specific example, except, of course, we see that some example of connection on some non-commutative version of principal bundle.
Last question? No? So let's thank the speaker again.